Hello, welcome to the Big Scuba Show.
Hey folks, my name is Abbie Barnes. I am a presenter, a filmmaker, and the founder of Spend More Time in the Wild, which is an organisation entirely dedicated to inspiring, empowering people to get outside for the benefit of mental and physical health. I'm really, really excited to be hanging out with you all today on the Big Scuba Podcast.
Hello everyone, welcome back to the Big Scuba Podcast. My name is Ian, I am your dive master for this episode. Welcome. This is episode 161, and with me also is my lovely co-host.
Hello, this is Gemma here. I'll introduce myself.
Yes, woo, here we are.
161, and it's, yeah.
161, I know. So, yeah, we got some more guests. We've got Abbie Barnes, who you may know from the YouTube world, who does lots of exploring. She's a diver, but she also does a lot of walking up mountains and hills and you name it.
In very extreme places.
She is, yeah. Wears a hat, sunglasses, and you may know her on the YouTube world as...
So it's Abbie Barnes, but her company is Spend More Time in the Wild.
Yeah, so look out for her. But she's coming up to talk about what she does and diving and how she got into diving. Usual sort of story, really.
Yes, yeah. So it's quite interesting.
I wanted that comparison about, you know, diving in depths and also going up the mountains and hills. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, she is very popular in the hiking world. She's UK based, but obviously she goes around the world doing amazing hikes and taking groups and does corporate stuff, and she does public speaking. So, but she's got an interesting story. So, yeah.
Which is good.
Yeah.
We like people with interesting stories.
We do.
I've been riding around in a truck, and you've got a new BCD.
I have, yes. Yeah, so we've been it's been a hectic 2 weeks since we last were on the airwaves.
So we dived last at Stony Cove, didn't we?
We got
in there quickly.
Yeah, and then our previous episode, 160, was with Mallory Haas, so that came out 2 weeks ago. So if you want to listen back, and that's very interesting.
We better just mention, actually, for people who follow Mallory, she's got a special weekend coming up down in Plymouth.
Yep, 1,000 tyre project clear up.
Yeah, so if you're in the Plymouth area and you're down there, and make contact with Mallory and say you want to get involved and lend a hand, and there's all hands to the pumps down there.
Yeah, you don't have to be a diver either. You can help with the shore cleans and the foreshores. So, yeah, have a look at the Ships Project website, and it will take you. There's a link on there to the 1,000 Tyre Project, so you can find out a bit more.
Yeah, and we hope that goes really well, and she gets lots of support for that. That'd be really cool.
Yeah. And then after we've spoken to Abbie Barnes, we've got a little bonus episode at the end.
We
catch up with our friends from Lundy Diving, Sammy and Ben.
Yeah, so there'll be details about how you can get your next diving trip all planned and booked in. And by sound of it, you need to really quickly, because they had a really busy year, and next year looks as though it's going to be even busier. And they're even taking bookings into 2025.
Yeah.
So we'll be giving you details about how you can get your booking, and also open water swimming as well, because they're doing a lot of that as well.
Yeah, Ben's sister, who's also called Gemma, she's done swimming with the seals. So that's she's done over 100 sessions this year.
Yes.
Just incredible. Nice. Yeah. So yeah, they should be all very chuffed with themselves for what they've achieved this year.
Yeah, definitely. We should also say as well, a really special birthday as well for BZAC, 70 years, which is really cool.
Yes, yeah, that was in the social media, so that's a pretty amazing achievement, isn't it?
Yeah, so 70 years, agency and club that is, you know, so many people have come through their training, and, you know, what, you know, what a difference they've made, really, to the diving world.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Yeah, so that's that. And then we've got, we're going on a little road trip in mid to the end of October.
It's fine, isn't it?
Yes, to, we're going to the motorhome show.
Yeah, look forward to that. Should be good.
Yeah, because it kind of, although it's not a diving show, but it kind of, it does impact on what we do in the outdoors. So,
well, it does, doesn't it? Because, you know, we, how many times have we talked about, you know, with vehicles and people use them for all sorts, but, you know, you could have a dive weekend away staying in your motorhome. So,
like we've done.
Like we've done with the Ford Custom Nugget.
Yes.
A couple of times. And had, you know, really good weekend doing that.
Yeah, and prove that, you know, it makes a good dive vehicle. So
yeah, got managed space, but it is possible.
Yeah.
And, you know, for people who are into the hashtag van life and, you know, van conversions, and, you know, there's going to be all sorts of companies who specialize in van conversions and professional ones and actually home, you know.
Yes, yeah, exactly. So, yeah, so, all, you know, diving's diving, but we need the vehicles to get us to and from the dive sites. And, you know, you've been trialing a Ford Ranger.
So my previous car, that died a death, unfortunately. And I've been looking around for what my next vehicle is going to be. And, you know, I really enjoyed having the Ford Ranger a couple of weeks ago, thanks to Buses. They lent that to me for a couple of days to have a go, and that's part of the reason why we went to Stony, wasn't it?
Mm.
Take that up and drive it, and that was a great drive. Really enjoyed it. Lovely looking truck inside and out.
Yeah, it was great. Yeah.
Lots of toys on it, and yeah, you know, watch this space. You know, it could be the next big scuba dive truck.
And I've been looking at vehicles because I'm a convertible two-seater girl, but that's not a very practical dive vehicle, is it?
Yeah, so, you can't get a lot of dive kit.
No, it's a bit of a struggle. So yeah, I've test drove Mazda and Hyundai so far, and yeah, we've got a few more test drives lined up. So
yeah.
But yeah, so it's been interesting.
And have you been looking at them for a diving point of view? You know,
yes, well, diving and a bit more outdoor life. So to fit the paddleboard in, dive equipment, making sure, yeah, the boot is big enough and, yeah, smooth or flat enough to get stuff in. So
yeah, that, you know, that is important, because otherwise I think if you've got like one of them cars, a hatchback, I guess, where you get that lip.
Yeah, it's not practical.
Not really, you know, if you're using the back of the car to get geared up, which a lot of us do, you know.
Yes, yeah, yeah. So, but yeah, again, yeah,
you
watch this.
Your truck then.
Well, I would, yeah. Yeah, it's interesting, yeah, navigating the car sales people.
Oh, yeah.
So, but yeah, we're both on a little bit of a car journey at the moment, so yeah.
I've got my eye on a black Raptor. That's what I'm hoping. Fingers crossed. We'll see what happens.
So, but we'll give you an update maybe on the next podcast or in a couple of episodes of what we've accomplished with our vehicles.
We should also, as always, give a big shout out and a big thank you who support us every month with our many escapades and help us. And, you know, they're a great team. And that's our friends at Narked at 90.
Yeah,
you know, and we should hopefully be diving, you know, with the Honeymeister, should be diving in a couple of weeks.
In October sometime. Yeah.
And we'll have, if you look out for the flag, we'll have our usual array of Narked at 90 slap straps. And thanks for everyone who came up and took one and said hello. That's really good. And we'll have the Shearwater dive computers where you can come and try one, and if you're thinking about buying one, we can give you a voucher where you can save some money, which is really cool.
Yes, yeah, I think it's 10% off, so yeah, for one of those more expensive purchases, it's definitely worth having.
Christmas is coming. Now's the time.
Yeah, and we've been promoting on social media. Knocked at 90 also do gifts for the diver in your life. Yeah. So they've got some lovely sort of resin and wooden lamps that are really striking. So you have a look at their website.
They're up an underwater theme, aren't they?
They are. So they've got divers in, but it is an underwater themed lamp. So, you know, it looked really impressive on somebody's desk or in your office. We've also promoted the protectors for the dive computers, the silicon like rubber covers.
Yeah, they're really snazzy, aren't they?
Yeah, just depends what your budget is, really. Knocked at 90 have got something for everybody's budget, really. And then we took the dive canister underwater at Stony. Yeah. Yep.
So the idea of one of those, if you think, what's that about? Well, it's about the size of a sort of a large can of drink.
Yeah, I'd say a Coke can size.
Yeah. And you can unscrew it. It's made out of a really tough compound plastic, which has been machined, really expertly done. And, you know, that is you open it up and it's hollow, and you can put like a one of those, what do we call them?
They were made to put beacons in, so that, yes, yeah, personal beacons. So if you're lost at sea, crack that open, and obviously, yeah, it sends an automatic response up to the satellites, and you'd be found.
You're rescued, yeah.
Yeah.
So it takes all the bashing and knocking of anything, you know, you're going to put it underwater, and keeps it safe.
So potentially it's got it, you know, one of the uses you could, if you do a lot of sea diving, potentially you could put your beacon in that. And, you know, if there's ever that kind of risk that you might surface and be no boat around, you've got something that will aid your rescue. But equally, it's probably got other uses. So even if you're not a diver, you could take it up a mountain and keep things dry. And, you know, it's got attachments, so you can put it on a D-ring. You can put it on webbing. It's got a slot that you can slide that through, so
put keys in it.
So definitely worth a look. And, you know, if you're looking for something or you can't think of something to buy somebody,
there we go on the 90s website, and they'll have something for the person who's got everything.
Yeah. And if you're completely stumped, give them a ring and say what your predicament is, and I'm sure they'll help.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay, well, that's really cool. I think, we need to talk about your BCD.
Yes. So
what made you order a new BCD?
Well, I've been using a Mares Kayla. So it was gifted. So it might be a bit on the small side. So I've been using that the last couple of years. But
now, you liked the Mares one, didn't you? Because
I did, and I do.
What's the weight set up on that?
Yeah, it's got the SLS system. So literally it's green. It clicks in, you hear it click, and it goes green. So, you know, it's fully attached. And if it's red, you know, they're going to fall out. So
when we do our buddy checks, it's a really easy visual sign. Just because with some BCDs, like the one I've got, you have to listen for that click. You don't hear the click, then you know those integrated weights are not in.
No.
But with yours, you get a visual indication, don't you? Indicator.
Yeah. So I've stuck with Mares. I've gone for something quite simple, Prestige. Just ordered a size up, but I just didn't want anything too complicated. No great big pockets or anything. So we'll see how we get on. So just a standard BCD.
Maybe trying a wing.
Yeah, I didn't want to go full out. I thought I'd better keep it simple. And so definitely it's just moving on, getting size that hopefully fits a little bit better, and see how I get on.
Yeah, that'd be what's your thoughts of a wing? I think it'd be really cool if any of our listeners can get in contact to let us know what they're, you know, are they a BCD diver or are they a wing diver?
Or you can get these hybrid type BCDs now as well. I'd be, definitely, if you've got any comments or recommendations, I'm always open to, sort of trying a different setup.
Yeah, I think, especially in the pool, we can always book some pool
time and try
something.
Yeah, so it'd be quite exciting for our next trip to Stony, new BCD.
Yeah, that'd be really, really snazzy. Nice one.
Yeah, so I think that's probably everything. So we've got We've got plenty of guests booked in for recording. So we're recording next Monday, next Friday, and the following week. We've got Chris Lemons Monday.
Last breath.
We've got Bobby Sholly Friday.
Yeah.
A couple of days. We've got Joanna Wybreck. Girls.
Joanna goes as what on Instagram?
I think girls at CCR.
Yeah, that's right.
So she's a rebreather. We've
Kate
got
Harty from
Immersion Free Diving. Yeah. Free Diving. And then we've got Chris Taylor, who's local to us, but an amazing photographer and drone pilot. Yeah, so exciting guests coming up.
And Laura Parks as well.
Oh, Laura, yes. Yeah, so scuba diver instructor. So if you've got any recommendations for guests, I think we're kind of covered basically for this year. But yeah, we're
we should probably squeeze the odd one.
I think we could.
It'd be probably good. So if you have got a story to tell, get in contact, you know, and yeah, we'll get you booked in and let's share your story about your diving and, you know, your history. That'd be really cool.
Put you on the podcast airwaves.
Yeah, let's do it.
So I think that's everything. So I think we're all ready to listen to Abbie Barnes and then the boys from Lundy Diving, Ben and Sammy, after Abbie.
That'd be brilliant. Okay, let's do it.
This is episode 161. Brilliant.
Cool.
So welcome to the Big Scuba podcast, Abbie. It's really lovely to have you here.
Oh, I'm so excited to be here. It's crazy that I'm on a scuba diving podcast, but hey, we're all people doing life, right?
Exactly.
And it's good to see you dressed for the party. You've got your Stay Wild t-shirt on,
yeah,
and the hat and sunglasses.
Brand representation and sun representation, even though it's dark.
Yeah, we're recording this on a Monday early evening, about 6:30.
In the middle of a storm. What could be better? What can go wrong?
We'll see how it goes.
So tell us all about your journey into diving, because I know you're big on YouTube and you know, you got lots of followers, but you've also, you know, got into diving. How did that happen?
It's really exciting, actually. So my background is wildlife conservation and outdoor expedition. So it's all about helping people connect with nature, have meaningful experiences, so they want to protect the natural landscape for future generations to come. But also through my work, I am very sort of personal and vulnerable on my hiking journeys. I go out and do these big trails by myself around the world, but particularly Europe at the moment. And I share sort of my mental health journey, my experiences with chronic pain, and I use nature as a metaphor and that trail as a metaphor to inspire people on their life's journeys to work through the obstacles and difficulties that they're facing, particularly invisible ones such as mental illness and chronic pain. But often what I find is the way I find my thrive in life is really annoying, but I seem to have to face my fears. And water is something I'm actually very scared of. Now, it's not always been like that. As a kid, you know, we grew up on the southwest coast, just 10 minutes from the beach. So we'd always be there playing in the surf, building sandcastles, doing all that sort of thing. But sort of in my late teenage years, the fear really grew based upon some circumstances, which we can go into if you want to. And I've sort of just avoided watery places and the coast for a fair few years. And it was actually in 2020 that I decided I wanted to try and face that film. So me and my partner, that fear, me and my partner were in the south of Italy, where there's beautiful coastlines and it's very tempting to go to cool down. And I was indeed tempted, and I got some snorkeling kit and basically went from dipping my toes to actually full on snorkeling, which is probably for people listening here, you know, it's just like, well, good for you, cool, like, whatever. But, you know, for me, it was amazing. Like, I'm a dead weight in the water. I'm phenomenal at sinking. So the fact that I was even staying on the surface was one thing. But what was just amazing was the lure of the aquatic life really helped me push through that fear. And I wouldn't say that it's gone away, but what I'm doing now is getting into scuba diving. So I did my open water actually back in 2013. So I was a wee whippersnapper, fresh to the world, super keen to get underwater. Then this fear thing happened. And now I'm really returning to to the ocean, as I'm sort of saying at the moment. And in this year, 2023, I've done my advanced and I've done some paddy speciality qualifications as well, all with my local club.
What ones have you done?
So I've done rec, I've got my dry suit, I've just done navigation, and I've got peak performance booked in for a couple of weeks as well, which is really exciting.
Yeah.
So I can't even express how much I am loving it. It is amazing. Recently been to Lundy Island as well and dived with the seals, and it is just happening. Like, my world is becoming salty quite rapidly, and it's I'm very happy with that.
Yeah, no, that's so. Did you do like a refresher course from 2013 to when you got back into it in 2020?
Yeah, so my birthday's in June, which is a great time of year to have a birthday because it's sunny somewhere in the world usually. And again, we were in Italy, and my partner's mum booked me a scuba diving refresher down in Italy. And I was like, oh, crap, I really need to get into this now. You can't deny your partner's mother, can you?
No.
I went and I just fell in love with it once again. And yeah, so it was from there that, you know, things have snowboarded, and I'm really putting a lot of time and attention into it. But yeah, it was refresher. Then I went straight to the advanced, which we did at Vobster Key down here in the Southwest. So it's freshwater. Yeah. And to be honest, pretty much most things I've been doing have been in freshwater. But I am excited to see the ocean.
Well, it's really good that you've done your dry suit as well, because, you know, so you're not limiting just to, you know, warm water diving, and you know, because there's so much to see in the UK for UK diving. And doing that dry suit enables you to be able to do that, and in the comfort, you know, and all year round as well.
Yeah, I have to say, first of all, I love the dry suit because you do feel like a living legend when you're walking around in it on land. Like, yeah, not gonna lie, like, I look cool.
But then, you know,
the hat is full feature. I do take it off
a bit
underwater,
wet
though.
And soggy underwater, then.
No, I have to protect it. And yeah, but then it is really nice, you know, when the water's cold to obviously stay dry most of the time. I don't actually have my own kit yet, so I'm still renting from my club. But I'm really excited for that day to, you know, really have my own stuff and sort of christen it into the water. But, you know, more than anything, what's just so humbling about this experience is, you know, I'm very privileged in the fact that I've seen so much of our country, the land, that is. You know, I have traveled to the furthest corners, I've done really intense expeditions that have literally involved like every national park and thousands of miles. And I won't lie, I've reached a point where I've got a bit bored of the UK. And suddenly, you know, having this scuba diving world, like this entire new place of exploration has opened up, and it's amazing. I'm like, well, I could go to this country and film this hike, which involves a lot of effort and sweating and being lonely, or I can hang out with super cool people and go and find some wildlife and dive in a new place and learn something new. So it's like, well, yeah, I want to put some time and energy into that.
That's
now.
Awesome.
Fantastic. Yeah, and you're in a great location in the country because you've got all the South Coast diving. It's just, and that's pretty much all year round, whereas we're a bit restricted on our coastline because it's it is a very narrow window because of the visibility. But yeah, the South Coast is just a...
So we need to give a shout out to your dive setting. Who's your local dive setting? Who you normally hire your kit from?
It's Scuba Blue. They're my local dive center based in Taunton. And Midge and Vix, oh my gosh, they're just... They have taken me under their wings. I feel so loved and supported. You know, I'm very open about the fact that, guys, like, I'm really anxious about this. This is a big deal. And their tagline... What was that?
Nothing wrong with that at all.
No, that's it. Exactly. You got to be honest to you know, to help other people as well, and other people understand you. But their tagline is start diving, keep diving. And I'm like, oh, man, you got me.
Right. I totally agree with that, you know, and I don't think fear is a necessarily a bad thing. Being able to control it and manage it, yeah, definitely. And I think that way it keeps you grounded in when, you know, because we are venturing into the unknown to a degree. And also, you know, we're in an environment where we're not meant to be there. And so why not be, you know, have your fears, but manage them.
Yeah, that's it. And it's, you know, what's just so interesting is, you know, as I've mentioned, my work is more in expedition.
Yeah.
And, you know, I often find myself finding in very remote and isolated places where you know that you're on the fringes of where humans can exist. You know, whether that's the plains of Iceland, where in a week's time it's going to be under 3 meters of snow. Or, you know, earlier this year, I was on top of Mont Blanc, the highest mountain in Western Europe. Like, wow. You're up there and you're just like, yeah, humans really are not meant to be here. Like the snap of a finger and it's sort of all over. Like you're so on the edge of the possibilities of life and what you can do within the atmosphere with your kit, with the weather. You know, it was minus 25. I got frost nip on my nose. It was 60 mile an hour gusts of wind. Like it was gnarly up there. And then, you know, I go diving at Lundy and you have that little wobble of anxiety. But the more you put yourself in those situations, the more you learn to coach yourself through them and yeah. go, okay, this is a response that's actually pretty healthy based upon the situation. Like, what are we going to do about this? And, you know, is this something we can move through or is this something we need to step back from? And you learn so much about yourself through that. And the fact that it translates into the diving as well is really cool. So I'm bringing all those skills to the, well, it's not the table, is it? But to the pond.
Yeah, so you've been at the heights where, you know, you can breathe, you know, there's nothing, but then we go underwater and it's completely an alien environment, but it's still, you know, you can, there is that similarity, to be on that kind of edge.
Yeah, well, it's like you're entirely dependent on your kit. You know, if on Mont Blanc, I'd lost my glove, like you could lose your hand. It's crazy because of the cold and underwater, you know, something goes wrong with your kit. Obviously, you've got your buddies, you do all your checks, you've got your backups. The idea is that something doesn't go wrong. But it's exactly the same in the mountains or when I'm hiking alone in weird and wonderful places. Like,
so who should you do Mont Blanc with then? Is it like a group up yet?
It was actually a group. I was commissioned in by a company to make a film, very raw, honest film, as tends to be my style. So I'm looking forward to editing that. As always, there were many curveballs in the mix. So we'll see how it comes out. And hopefully I won't actually put people off.
And I guess you sleep up there as well.
Yeah, it's crazy. The highest hut on Mont Blanc is at 3,800 meters.
Wow.
And like the way it works is, you know, you do these big days to get to this hut. And this is your hut where you go to the summit from. And it looks like a spaceship. So if you look at the Guta hut, that's what it's called, from the Guta route, and it looks like a spaceship and it's just surrounded by snow. There's a severe drop off that it's looking out over. But what's just so funny is that the bottom room that you go into is all like rubber, because, you know, people go in there in their ice axes, their crampons, all the sharp stuff. That's where you like derobe, then you go up into the hut. But then when you want to just go outside to make a phone call, there's like this metal rim, but everyone's just stood there in the snow, in their Crocs, on the phone at 3,800 meters. I'm like, oh God, I love this mountain community. It's just hilarious. But yeah, if that hut wasn't there, like, you know, you'd be pretty screwed, really. It is the link between life and death for most of us up there.
Wow.
And do you ever relate the height of the mountain to like the depths of the sea and the oceans? Is that kind of translated across?
Absolutely. You know, the only thing is I'm looking up, not down. it's just that grand scale of things. You know, looking down, you know, if you've not got your ice axe and you slip and something goes wrong, it's game over. It's just that fragility and it's that awareness and it's that humility that you have to have by knowing that you're in a landscape that's greater than yourself, you know.
Doesn't that show you how hard diving is? Because if you look on the I'm not taking anything away from what you're doing with climbing the mountains, you know, when you look out on just the sheer height and depth, you know, to go 100 meters up a mountain is one thing, but to go down to 100 meters, that's a whole different level, you know, and that's massive, you know, amount, and but 100 meters to climb is not a huge amount.
Yeah,
a part of a mountain, especially when the mountain's 3,000 meters high. Go down that depth with
It's a very refreshing perspective, actually, and I've thought about this a fair amount. Like, there are parallels, but at one point, it really does drop off, and there's quite severe differences. Like, as a human, we can get away with so much more on the land.
Yeah.
You know, it's if you know your stuff, like, generally speaking, if you've got a knife on you and you're somewhere with wood, like, you can survive. Yeah. Underwater, like, you know, lost at sea without anything, what are you going to do? It's bonkers, really. I am not necessarily volunteering myself for a human experiment, okay?
Yeah, but the main thing about diving and, you know, mountaineering and hiking is doing what you're happy doing. It's and what makes you happy. But, you know, like, you do maybe step outside your comfort zone to kind of push a little bit further on, but you have to be ready for that to do it.
I think it's really cool that you've looked at your self with how you've covered the UK, and if you hadn't got into diving, you then lose that whole part. So, you know, I was talking to my daughter much earlier in the year about diving, and we were like walking along the beach, and I was saying to her, you know, because she learned to dive this year, she's 13, and I said to her, you know, all this time we've been walking along Southwold Beach, you know, always done ever since they were, you know, she was a baby with and my son, and you know, now she's getting to that's she's had that chance, now she can dive, to see underneath. And because if you can't dive, you can only you can go to maybe like SeaWorld or something and get an idea and the stuff on telly, but until you see underneath the waves for your own eyes, can you actually really absorb that and understand and see all the life that there is? And it's good that you've done that, and so because that way otherwise you'd miss out a whole big part of the environment in the UK, and you're passionate about the environment as well, aren't you?
Yeah, and you know, I think you're really hitting on something there. You know, it's for people to connect with something, they really need a tactile experience. You know, the senses need to be engaged, and whether that's something on the land or in the water. And it's one thing to, you know, watch an Attenborough documentary and go, oh, that was nice, any more popcorn, you know, and it's another to actually, you know, go through the experience, like to smell the kit, to feel it on your face, to like learn to be dependent on yourself and the people around you. And to go into these environments, you know, and you don't have to go deep, you know, and I think that's the thing, like there's so much life all around us on the coasts. And, you know, as a kid, we grew up rock pooling. Like I wanted to be a marine biologist at one point, and it's really nice to see that it's come full circle. But it's also that acknowledgement that like life on land depends on life in the ocean and vice versa. You know, we're not independent like entities. We're completely independent. And that's really what I hope to communicate more as I share my journey getting back into the water and of discovery. Is obviously this is a very personal journey of discovery, but there's something for us all to learn from this. And straight away, you know, I'm like, I'm a mountain leader, I'm a walk leader, so I take people out into the hills privately, whether that's corporate or events that I actually host and run. But I'm like, oh, I wonder if we could do something like getting people snorkeling, or oh, could we do some rock pooling or beach combing or beach cleans? Like, what can we do? It's just always like thinking on a bigger scale, sometimes a little bit prematurely, but that's just my passion. And, you know, one of my favorite sayings is use this time, which when I was a personal trainer, people used to hate because I'd scream it at them and say, use this hour. but, you know, now it's like every day really does count. And like we can make a massive difference. Yeah, exactly. There's so much to explore. It's really cool.
And you've quite recently brought out a YouTube video of your experience in Lundy diving with the seals, and you know that comes over so well. And it's just because we've got the Lundy sweatshirt on here, Lundy Diving.
Love it.
They're big friends of ours. Yes. So what was the experience like? Was that your first sea dive?
First in a long time. So I had that short one in Italy, which was the refresher. But for me, this felt like the first proper one actually that I've done, because when I did my open water back in 2013, like that was all I did. And actually, I didn't really have a great experience from the open water. And I think that's why another reason why I sort of deviated away from the diving, because I didn't feel very supported, shall we say. And it doesn't really matter and where I am now, but the Lundy trip was really, really exciting. The excitement had to go on pause for the boat ride out. That was rather nauseating. Thankfully we all made it.
Yeah.
But no, I'm a filmmaker at heart, and filmmakers will always have a camera in their hand, whether it's for personal or not. So I took my little GoPro. That's all I've like had to use. And I was like, oh, I'm just going to see how it goes. And, you know, oh, it's steaming up. And oh, this is annoying. Just be in the moment, but I want to film it. So I had the little internal battle. But the first dive, you know, we really didn't go very deep. I think it was like 5 or 6 meters, which to me, again, showed that you don't have to be like crazy deep to have a cool experience. And the seals were really playing with our minds. Like they were sort of in and out of the shadows. Was that a seal? What was that? Like almost like a horror movie, but the opposite, because it was amazing. And then the second dive, that's when they were like, oh, go on then, you've come all the way out here. And they were just sort of playing hide and seek and coming up to like nibble the fins, as I know they often do for divers around Lundy. And like, I was just like laughing so hard. It was so fun. And I say in the film that like I didn't realize how big their eyes are. Like their eyes are huge and they're just there like looking at you. It's like, yes, I know I'm in your landscape. I know that you're watching me. But yeah, do you know what? Sometimes English is annoying because we lack the descriptive words that other languages have. And I think, you know, trying to describe the magic of being around a wild animal,
yeah,
and in its environment, you know, knowing that if it wanted to, whether it's a seal or anything else, like you could be hurt, like it doesn't feel like that at all. The fact that you feel like enabled to be in their environment, it is magical. It's completely enthralling. And I will smile about that trip for many years to come, because it was such a beautiful baptism back into the world of scuba diving.
Yeah.
That's certainly a good way to get back into it, and especially the sea diving. I know the steam out there is a bit, yeah, it's a soul making, yeah, kind of thing. We did it earlier. Well, when did we do it? No,
July, wasn't it?
July, wasn't it? Yeah. Okay. And it was, we laughed a lot.
And he was the only one that kept dry. He nearly lost his shorts, and I think he got to the stage where he just,
what was happening on this boat?
And then there was the girl who was sick over the side.
Lovely, it's a classic.
And we just sat there, and it was like buckets of water, salty water, just being
like
thrown
a film,
over.
Wasn't it?
Like you just wash, wash.
Oh, so, wow. Yeah.
The return journey was absolutely fine, you know, that was quite smooth, but it was quite, we timed it just with the big tides.
Okay.
Big tide that weekend.
Yeah.
And we kind of hit it, and that was quite entertaining. Cruise out.
How were your dives when you finally got there?
Well, we did. We went up to the Lundy Island, didn't we, to do a bit of a hike, actually. Yeah, we
nice.
Went up to the top and up to the lighthouse. And then, we had one dive as well. And we had, plenty of seals around, didn't we?
Yeah.
And that was Honey's first experience of seeing seals. That was her first sea dive, wasn't
amazing.
It?
Yeah.
Yeah,
Lundy Island itself as well is a really cool place, isn't it? It's something enchanting about it. I was first there in 2018 when I started Wild properly, and was filming a little walk there. I said, one day I'll
did you stay over on the island?
No, I didn't, but it's a very tempting thing to do, isn't it? Very unusual place.
Did you go up the lighthouse?
No, it was closed when I was there.
That was awesome. We went up.
Did you go up?
The view was amazing.
You had a good day for it then.
Yeah, it was lovely. Yeah, really good.
Yeah, and you just think, you know, there's nothing between you and, you know, the American Canadian coast, and you just
I'd love to be there on a storm winter time. Yeah. That'd be awesome.
Absolutely.
Yeah. But no, it's definitely, you know, a good bucket list kind of thing to do for UK diving.
Yeah, and Ben and Sam, they look after you as well on the boat, don't they? You know.
Yeah.
You know. You know, for anyone who's listening, who's thinking about booking up, yeah, it's a great place to go and get a dive, isn't it?
Totally. Yeah, really, really worth the the trip out. What?
Flat calm.
Well, yeah, I was told that that was one of the worst rides that the club have ever experienced, so it's not always that bad. Disclaimer. Thank you.
Yeah, let it go, Sammy.
It's that time in the podcast where we take you back to North Devon and catch up with RNLI coxswain Captain Ben Benji of the Barbara B Dive and Fishing Boat in Ilfracombe Harbour. Mind those ropes!
So how's the diving season been?
Phenomenal. Yeah. Phenomenal. Best year in, best year in 20 years. For work-wise. I mean, we started doing all them swim with seal trips this year.
Yeah.
And we were every day, if weather allowed, we were every day for 2 months straight.
That's good going, isn't it?
I've never felt how I felt this year. we got to September and I went, what the hell's happened? For weather-wise, it's been shocking. Probably like the worst year.
Really?
Ever, yeah. We nine weekends on the bounce, we either cancelled or only worked one of the days.
Oh, wow.
You'd get to a Wednesday, confirm, wake up on the Thursday morning, and like me or Sammy or me and Lee get one of the other skippers to text, and you'd have cancelled either Saturday or Sunday. It just changed so quick.
Well, you've done really well considering the weather then.
Yeah,
when we came out, that wasn't really part of the plan either, was it? I think
what was that
when we came out? That wasn't really part.
No. It's been a lot of that weather this year of get like halfway there and go, what's this, or why isn't it doing what we think it should be doing? Yeah, it's been a lot of interesting. Me and Sammy just head shaking and.
Just very uncomfortable weather.
When you were talking about the start, as the season was starting, you were saying that you had new props put on. Has that made a lot of difference as well?
That was
end of last year.
End of last year, I had new props put on, and I've ordered new props again.
Really? Oh, wow.
Yeah, so it's all like black magic props. It's like, rang five different companies and I had five different answers. So, like, Just hope for the best. Yeah, they should be here soon. We're in October now. Yeah, so they should be here this week or next week, hopefully.
And is that to make the boat faster still, or
more efficient?
Yeah, more efficient, faster, or same speed at lower revs and less load on the engine.
Yeah. That's good then.
Yeah, because we had the issue of we had to go five blade props and they're so torquey that when you're going, there's so much torque going through them, there's more load on the engine. When we were in the boatyard, we're in the yard in February, that we changed the skeg configuration. I say we didn't do nothing. The people in the yard said, this is what we're doing. And we go, yeah, that sounds like a brilliant idea. So now we can spin a bigger prop. Because when we put the prop on last time, it weren't fun. That was a day that, like, there's days that you remember.
Mm. But
changing the props last time was a day that, like, I'll never forget. Like, that was not a fun day, was it?
No.
But over the long period of time, that'll make a difference to your economy.
The new props will, because it'll be less load on the engine.
Yeah.
So hopefully it'll drop the engine load by about 10%.
Mm.
Keep the same speed but drop the load, so that means the lifetime of the engine should be like another 2 or 3 years.
Yeah,
so obviously we're only going at like these speeds during the summer months. In the winter we just go around like slow speed, like between 8 and 10 knots majority of the time, where like this time you're doing like between your 16s and your 18 knots to because Lundy's free, like, yeah, Lundy, it's not far away, but at the same time it is. Especially when you can't see it, like when you guys came, you can't see it, and then you're like, guys, it will get better, it will get better. like us trying to explain to you that it will get better, and you're like, oh, will it? And then when you get there, it's flat, it's like flat calm on the landing day and everything.
Yeah. Light at the end of the tunnel.
Yeah, light at the end of the tunnel. But us trying to explain to you that it will be flat, like we've said it this year, but us trying to explain to you that it will be nice when we get there, and you go in. Nah, these guys do not know what they're talking about.
I don't know.
And like, then you get there, and you're, and people are like, "Oh, yeah, you were right."
Yeah, that was. I mean, I thought the day was great. The ride out was great. Seeing other people suffer a bit, but yeah,
it's wet. It's very wet. I remember that.
Yeah, that's all this year's been is wet. I've never that day was the wettest I've ever had any boat.
I did sit there at one stage and it felt like somebody was just throwing buckets of water over me. As soon as I got clear, I got whack, another lot.
Because it wasn't fresh, it was just wet.
Yeah.
And I looked around, there's this water coming everywhere. I'm like, oh, Jesus. I hope it rains soon because there's going to be salt in places there shouldn't be salt.
Yes, no, it was we certainly laughed.
What I found quite amusing was the people hanging on to the side with their like coats and what have you, and I think they just got to the stage where they just didn't care anymore.
That's Chris. Don't worry about Chris. He'll throw up on a flat calm day. We don't like.
That's fine. I lost his shorts.
He'll be fine. Yeah. He'll be fine. Made a washing line on the boat to dry his clothes when he went on the island. So yeah, he was fine.
Oh, yeah. The island. That was really good to have a walk on the island. I know we kind of gave a dive up for that, but it was so nice to have a walk around and see the island and get up the lighthouse. And from the lighthouse, you could see the whole island, you know, from one point. And that was really awesome to do.
Just incredible. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's such a unique place. And like we said, especially this year, that to us the sea's so magical, but to everyone else the land is so magical.
Yeah.
And like, because me and Sammy have had to up our history with on the island, and like where before you might tell a white lie, now we can't tell white lies. We needed like there's been lots of late night reading and comparing information and facts between people, and
but that's good. And then, you know, it just makes it more part of you, doesn't it? And you're traveling over there right through the summer and the winter, and
it's my second home. The boat's my first home. Lundy's my second home. My house is actually like, that's a place I come crash.
So have you done much skippering, Sam?
Yeah, I've done a fair bit. Been with another skipper as my crew, just as like a sort of someone else that's there in case I need to ask any questions. But no, it's been really good.
Good.
I've built my confidence throughout the summer months. And it's been good. Enjoyed it.
Yeah.
Well, it's been good to sort of see you progress and grow, really. Yeah.
Eight years. We've been together. 8 years.
You're like an old married couple.
It is. It's when you know what he's saying by just like grunts. what we need, or like when I say something, you can hand me exactly what I said. I'm like, I never asked for that. And he was like, yeah, but that's what you wanted, weren't it?
How about your eye movements? What are you looking for?
So have you had any exciting diving stories or some diving adventures from your passengers? Anything? Or has it been fairly smooth?
I mean, like, the seal interaction we've had this year has been quite good.
Oh, the seal has been frisky.
Yeah.
There has been some frisky seals. There's been a lot of noises on the surface I haven't heard for a long time.
Really?
Yeah. I think, like, because this year we've done a lot of the swim with seals, we've been having a lot of, like, kids and, like, families and stuff.
Yeah.
So that's quite nice. Obviously, diving, you quite often see couples or... You do get families diving. We do a bit of stuff with schools and stuff, but like seeing younger kids going in with the seals and having a good time and interaction, that's quite nice.
Yeah.
We've seen that this year with the amount of swim and sea trips we've done.
Don't think there have been any fun.
No, a lot of like really close encounters with seals and stuff like that.
Like last year, I had the lithium battery fire. other than that, like, no, it's been a quiet.
Oh, that's good. That's good in some ways. Yeah.
But like Sammy said, because we've done more swimming with seals, that we haven't actually like done a lot of diving.
Mm.
Like sometimes it felt like we were just doing like days and days and days of just swimming with seals.
To give a
appeals to more people, I guess.
Yeah,
it's a good day out for people. Like the David, that we've had quite a lot of like good stuff from the David Attenborough documentary.
Yeah,
which me and Dad were on. We had quite a few people coming from that, and a lot of their swimming groups.
Mm.
So when it started, when Gemma's sister started like doing it all, it was just like find one swimming group. Like last year, I think she'd done 12 trips.
Yeah.
Wow. But this year, we're up to like 100 odd.
Amazing. She must be so chuffed.
Yeah. Mad as well.
Yeah. Yeah. And it's interesting the difference in like the hospitality between divers and swimmers. Of
in what way?
Divers, you go in the water for an hour.
Yeah.
Get back onto the boat for an hour, go back in the water for an hour, then we go in. Where like with the swimmers, you bet it's a 2 hour period of swimming.
Mm.
And it's like get on the off the boat as much as you want. You get people that go in. We had a group of women from Wales who stayed in for an hour and 50 minutes. Okay. Didn't get out, just stayed in for an hour and 50 minutes. And then you get other people. Last time we ran Dad's boat, we were like 10 minutes.
In and out. Mm.
That was it.
It's almost as if divers are a bit more predictable. Like, you know they're going to go in. You expect a couple of, like, oh, can I have some more weight? Or can I have this? Or can I do that? And once they're down, and they're, you know, they're diving. As with the swimmers as well, because they're on the surface, they're communicating with you. Can I do this? Am I doing this right? It's almost a lot more needy.
It's a lot more concentration.
Yeah.
Mm.
It's, we said, like, with diving, when you get in the up, like, you normally get in the arbor by 3-4 o'clock of an evening, yeah. But like with the swimming, you're not getting until 5-6.
Oh, okay.
So like it's just one of them where like, yeah, it's just the nature of the beast that you've set the standard to of how you want it to work.
Yeah.
So you have to be interacting all the time.
Yeah.
And that's why like this year, like, yeah, we're so tired. I'm still knackered now. I finished diving. Diving's done. Dive benches are off the boat.
Wow.
I'm ready. Yeah, we're ready for the other job. But like, yeah, I'm still catching up. But it's been a brilliant, brilliant year. Like I said, we've never been so busy. And like even my days off, like I've been on the other boat crewing. And Sammy's been with Carl or Sam's, yeah. So, but then next year it'd be a lot better. Now Sammy is happy taking the boat,
yeah.
And we actually have more crew next year, and it's not just like five of us again.
Yeah. That's good. Yeah. Well, it's character building as well, isn't it? So you've got through it.
it's one of them. Like with the year that we've had, it's like me and my mum said this morning. Like I don't actually know how we're here in October, and you can go, we've had a brilliant season.
Yeah.
But I don't know how we've got here. Like in my head, it's still like June.
This year,
I still think I'm on my first dive trip of the year.
Yeah. I don't know where this year's gone. It has gone really quick.
Yeah, yeah, it's just flown by.
But it means you're busy. You're enjoying it, and that's why it goes quick. Yeah.
The enjoyment's been there this year. Especially with how people's interactions have gone with seals.
Mm-hmm.
Like we've had divers, we had me and Sam, I done one day and Sam done the other day. We had four divers who do photography for the Scuba magazine.
Okay.
And they all said, weren't they? Like one of the best interaction we had.
For them.
But for them, it was like, it wasn't the best, but like to say to someone who, like the swimmers, if a seal swims by them, they're ecstatic. They can't, they don't, they're like, this is brilliant. But to like these divers, he done my longest dive. It's 3.5 hours.
Right.
He's literally in 2 meters of water, this photographer that's doing the seals, but like,
yeah.
And yeah, and then he was like, oh, we weren't the best, you know? And then like, you start talking, you're like, yeah. And he's like, well, then like, you start getting deep and like, oh, well, actually, yeah, they were there. And, but they weren't playing, but one was just sat there, and he starts showing you the picture. Like, well, yeah, it was all right. But yeah, the different interactions are very interesting.
That's a Lundy seal behind me.
Yeah, no, I thought you were at Lundy. I was like, your signal's better than ours. I want to know how you've done that.
The farms, they're not that, they haven't been for the last couple of years. They haven't really interacted that much for the last couple of years up there. You know, they do with, you know, down at Lundy, but as you know, but at the farms, for some reason, they used to.
Yeah.
I think of early years, right, when I used to go up there.
They just kind of popped their heads up, didn't they? And no, like, nibbles or anything.
No, you know, it seems sort of the last couple of years, they seem as though they've sort of gone away from that, really. I don't know why that behaviour would have changed.
Yeah.
So have you seen much other wildlife, like dolphins, whales? Have you seen much else out there?
Dolphins,
yeah.
Tuna.
Yeah.
Tuna?
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
A tuna, the same size as Sammy, jumping in the air.
Whoa.
on the west side of Lundy. Yeah. I was on Dad's, but Sammy was on mine, yeah. And I was upstairs cleaning the roof when the divers were in the water, and I was like, what's that? Let's jump probably 50 metres away from the boat.
Wow.
And yeah, it was there for 15, 20 minutes just jumping.
Man,
yeah,
so just hung around.
What else we had? That's it.
Yeah.
It's been, I haven't seen a sunfish this year, which is weird.
No, again, I think the weather's not helped in that sense with...
But whales, do you ever see any of them?
Occasionally, but then like we say it to a lot of the people that we take out, the amount of things that we probably steam right past, and we're completely oblivious. Well, we're always looking for wildlife, we're always got our eyes open,
yeah.
But what's underneath you or what's around that pops up behind the boat that you don't see, or
yeah,
I don't know.
We've had quite a bit this year where you steam past dolphins when they've been feeding and they're not going to interact. No one on the back of the boat will notice, and you'll see the fins come up behind the boat where they're just up for air and back down feeding. Yeah, no one noticed on the boat. So it's how much concentration you pay around.
Yeah.
Last whale we had was
the minke.
Yeah, minke, 3 miles west of Ilfracombe.
Mm.
Yeah, two years ago.
Yeah, it was on this boat.
Yeah,
every. Go on. No, I was just going to say every season is going to be different, isn't it? Because of the weather and the stream, you know. Yeah.
But I guess you
the Gold Streams
and orcas that far south.
Yeah, we have had orcas.
Oh dear.
Yeah. Well, you'd have thought that we're adamant. When was the seals? The seals staring at us.
Oh, 2, 6, 7 weeks ago.
That's late.
Staring
that.
At you.
So the seals don't normally get too close to the boat, and it was come the end of the season they get closer. But it must have been like end of July, start of August.
Yeah.
And there was like 6 or 7 seals, like 2 or 3 meters away from the boat, whilst divers were jumping in. and normally when they jump in, the seals like get a bit scared and duck and scurry under the water. Nothing. They just stayed there and they were giving us direct eye contact.
Yeah, and they were the big males as well. So like normally you get a lot of the interaction. Stuff like that you normally get from the pups because they're really inquisitive. Not so much pups, but like a couple years old. But to have a male that size, a fully grown male, dread to think how old he is, but just sat there with what looked like another female, just watching, almost as if like as soon as a diver would jump in the water, they'd turn their head and watch.
Yeah.
As a
That's a bit spooky.
Yeah.
It was proper weird. I mean, we thought there was something around, but we didn't see anything. It was nice weather at the time, so if we didn't, you would have seen if something was there. Yeah, it's proper mm-hmm. strange.
Maybe they could hear something.
Yeah, possibly.
Mm-hmm.
Mm, yeah. Oh, well, it's good. It's been, yeah, one of the best years. So have you been busy on the lifeboat?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
You had a couple of shouts the other night, didn't you? I saw you post.
Yeah. Me and Sammy were there. We were there together on the little boat with our knees. Yeah, still recovering now. I've still got a bad shoulder.
Like to work.
It's like it's the depressing thing is I've got another lifetime on that boat yet, so I can walk off of it retiring. It really depressed me that did. It's been busy. We had search for two overdue walkers, a few tow jobs.
So the start of the year, like we said to you, we had a few dogs.
Mm.
Yeah. You get paddle boarders, quite a few paddle boarders this year, same as you get every year in the middle of summer.
Being dragged out by the wind.
Yeah, dragged out by the wind or the tide, or like exhaustion. You get a few, there's sort of two paddle boarders that are really competent. Right. And they won't go out in the nice, fat, calm days, they'll go out when it's blowing. right. And
life jackets.
Yeah, everything with him. Really good, but for someone that's on the coastal path and sees him paddling along, even though he's making it all right way to anyone else, it's terrible conditions and looks like he's in distress. So we've had a few shouts to him this year where we go out, "You all right, mate? Yeah, all good. Just going back again to heal."
He's like a world. He's like in the world champions of paddleboarders.
Mm.
It's really good.
Yeah, probably take his son works for one of the dive companies in Ilfracombe. He's an instructor. And literally I said to him, start of summer, I haven't been out for your dad for a while, and that night on training, yeah. He'll tell me to go and see.
Yeah.
It's like, "Hello, mate. You don't know me, but I know you." Yeah, a few yacht toes. Yeah, quite a few. A lot of toes this year, a lot of toes.
Mm.
That's normal cutoffs and all of that.
Yeah. So are you on call pretty much all the time then while you're not at sea?
Yeah, all the time.
Whenever we're not at sea, we're always on call, unless if you're in town, and if you go out of town it's for an hour or so.
Well, that's really good. That's looking after the people out there.
Yeah.
We try to.
So what's the next few months holding for you? What have you got? Is it back to Welks?
Well, I'm off to France tomorrow.
Are you?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. I've got 2 weeks holiday now, and then end of October, start putting the work pots out.
Okay. What part of France?
Pardon?
What part of France?
Lille.
Mm.
Oh, right, yeah.
Going to watch rugby.
Oh, that'll be out. Awesome.
Yeah, 3 days of watching rugby and finding a nice bar to go and go and find some local temperatures and see what the locals are saying.
Yeah. Oh, that'll be awesome. Yeah. So nice to get away, I'm sure.
Pardon?
Can you speak any French?
Bonjour.
Bonjour. Je voudrais un baguette. I know that.
Yeah, bonjour. That'll do. I'm sure sign language for like where's
just go that always gets you through.
I will keep that in mind.
Yeah, always gets you through. Always gets you out of a muddle.
Yeah, so then you're back straight into the Welks then.
Yeah. And then it'll be Christmas, then it'll be January, then it'll be starting the season all over again.
Where's the year gone?
When's the dive season really kind of finish? And
last trip is the end. When is it? Our last trip is the 24th.
Oh, is it? All right.
Yeah, on Obsession, yeah.
3 weeks then.
Yeah, it's a 4-day stay at Lundy. I got the first 2 days, and then the other skipper's got the last two. And then the jobs list starts on that boat then.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, lots of jobs to be done this year.
Yeah. So did you, because I think when we spoke to you last, you were going to have a night over at Lundy. Did you actually get that? Did you get your night? Or you were staying on the boat?
We have had a couple.
We've only had one. Yeah, that had been... That was... when was that? That was a long time ago now.
That was when we went around the West Island.
It was when we went around the West. That's when the boat was covered in puffin poo.
Puffin poo?
Puffin poo, yeah.
What was you doing with puffin poo?
Well, we had to stay on the other side of the island. Start of June. Yeah, we had to stay on the other side of the island because it was an easterly wind.
Right.
So the east side of the island would have been a bit choppy. So luckily, we got up into the pub to have dinner. And then the steam round into Jenny's Cove, and that's where predominantly all the bird life lives on the island. Then, woke up at 4 a.m. to puffins going nuts. And then when I actually woke up and looked at the boat, I went, why is it yellow?
No,
the moon was yellow. We had about 20 minutes of washing the boat down.
But they did that deliberately, I guess, did they? Because you were like,
No. It's what it is, ain't it? You can't moan about it.
At least
it was like before it like warmed up, so like at least I could wash it off and like the seagull poo you normally get, where it's like been there for a week. And you're like, oh, geez, here we go again.
Well, that's good you got there and you got to the pub and everything.
So if you get this last trip in and get to the pub again and see him again next year.
That's all good. And Gemma will carry on doing the swimming with seals.
Yeah, Gemma's going back to actual work middle of this month, I think.
What does she do for real work?
intensive care sister.
Really? Wow.
Yeah.
Gosh.
So go back to her real job.
Yeah. So she's really lucky, I suppose. So she finished that in the summer and then she can go back.
No, it was with the circumstances with Dad passing. Like they wrote 6 months of leave.
Right. Okay.
And then she just kind of jumped in on that to keep herself occupied.
Yeah.
She didn't really. None of us realised the beast that she'd made. But she's doing all her boat tickets at the moment. So she's done her power boat level 2. Done a VHF course the weekend. She wants to start doing a bit more on the boat side of things. So I said, Sammy could teach her, like, that's better. Yeah.
That's good. And yeah, your mum must be so proud of all of you, for what you've done, this season.
Yeah, it's been I don't know how we got here, I still don't believe it, Maria. I'm still like getting ready to like wake up and like realise it's June. We got to do it all over again.
Well, at least you're still smiling, so that's amazing.
I don't know if that'd be a good dream or a bad dream.
it's great. It's been a huge success, and in great memory of your dad, really. He must be looking down on you, very proud.
He'd be saying why we're working so much, but needs must. Next year will be different. I remember having the chat with him last year. I said, next year I'll start having a bit more time off. Still start giving Sammy the boat. Well, that never happened this year, did it?
No. Well, hopefully the weather will be a bit kinder next year.
Let's hope so.
Yeah.
It must be during our Indian summer or whatever you call them.
So if people want to start thinking about booking a dive or a swim with seals for next year, when do you open the books up?
Now. The diary we got booked into 2025. We're nearly fully booked every weekend for the main season.
Wow.
That's amazing.
And then we will have a website. So hopefully next time we talk to you, we will have a booking website and it'll just be able to book online.
Well, that'd be good, wouldn't it?
It'll make Gemma a lot happier as well.
Yeah.
for having to make up like her Facebook feeds, just like group after group after group after group.
Well, it worked a treat, you know. She puts in her Facebook group, didn't she? And
it's because a lot of people do like the Facebook groups because they like knowing who else is going to be like I understand that you can go on the Facebook group and go, oh, who else is on the boat with me today, right? Yeah, that, so when you're down there you can like look out for whatever person. So we're trying to find a website that can will put everyone in a group.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because we had one group this year, but all single travellers, and they met up the night before and went out for dinner with each other, which is lovely. And also you can share pictures coming into the day.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's
a good idea. We're really trying to work out how we can do that, but I'm not technology.
Are you technology?
Not that far. All right, okay.
Yeah.
We're outside, so not
technology either. Yeah, because we had a lady in the pub the night before saying, I've seen you. Yeah. Thinking, who are you? It's just but no, it's good because it makes it more social on the boat as well, doesn't it? And it's a good experience to share with everyone as well. It's just at the moment it's just go to the website and then give
the website, Lundy Diving Facebook page, Instagram. I don't understand Twitter anymore. I just don't understand that. No, Facebook or Instagram, really. Send us a message, bring us, me and Mum will answer, and we will get you booked on and get ready to see you next year.
We'll put the links in the show notes and then hopefully you'll get a few more inquiries and for a fun
thank trip. You very much.
Next year. It's been really great to see such a successful season as well, and we had a lot of fun as well, so
thanks for looking after us, that was brilliant.
My pleasure.
Anytime. I'll get actual buckets of water for you next time. Don't worry.
You needed like one of those hats, you know, like those yellow hats. Just like that.
Yeah,
it was definitely memorable, but a lot of fun. And we highly recommend it to everybody we talk to.
Thanks very much.
So have you got any diving plans? Have you got any trips to combine with diving?
Well, it's something that I'm trying to sort of figure out a bit. You know, I've already mentioned I don't have my own kit, which is a little bit more of an obstacle just because I need to coordinate like hiring it, picking it up, going somewhere, dropping it back, all that jazz, which for simple-minded folk like me is a lot of logistics. I'm hoping to go diving on Chesil Beach in a couple of weeks, which would be really cool. I'm really keen to do a night dive actually, but I am home alone with my very old little dog and he's very anxious being left. So I don't really want to like leave him in my van when I'm out in the dark because he will completely lose the plot. So that has to wait until some family are back to look after him, but I'm trying to fit in what I can around him. But Chesil Beach and just whatever I can locally really. It's kind of funny because this time of year I'm like, cool, yeah, I've just done like a really big season, you know, I've been traveling full time since early April. I'm like, oh, it's a down season now, it's time to edit. And then I look at my diary like, when am I gonna edit? Like, there's so much to do.
And so do you normally do a lot of recording and then edit stuff a bit later on in the year?
Yeah, so essentially the last few years, sort of my strategy has been, you know, April, when the clocks have sort of changed and we've got a bit more daylight, I tend to go north and I pick some sort of more local trails in the UK, which sort of essentially just help me get my hiking legs back, because as I've mentioned, hiking is what I do predominantly. And throughout the year, I will just say, you know, I run events, so I am still walking and to the fridge a lot, you know, that I get some miles there. So early in the year, I'm hiking, creating films, basically waiting for the snow in Europe to go away so that I can go and hike there in bigger and wilder places. So come sort of late May, June time, depending on the season, that's when I generally tend to be traveling further afield. And then I either stay away and do trail and connect them all, which is exhausting, I will just say, or I come home for a week or two, sort of recharge everything, try and recharge myself, and then go back out for the next one. So I am just under a month back from my last hike, which was 3 weeks hiking solo in the Arctic Circle in Sweden. So I still feel like I'm adjusting to being back actually, but yeah, it's interesting. And then so then the goal is when I finish the season, sort of September, October time, I'm sort of back in the UK and I try and stay here as much as I can, generally because that's when the festivals tend to happen. Like companies bring me in to do talks, whether in person or remotely. And I really actually have to force myself to sit at the computer and edit some of the incredible footage that I've worked really hard to capture, because, you know, that is kind of my job, is to share these stories and not just be like, woo, adventure. So, yeah.
So what predominantly do you do, a lot of corporate work, or is it, do you kind of mix it up? Is it just really what comes through the door?
Yeah, so I'm not shy at all about talking about sort of the income streams that I've worked to create, because, you know, what I do is unusual. And yeah, I think for a lot of people, it's like, well, how do you make a living just traveling all the time? And like my nemesis comment is, oh, you're just on holiday all the time. I'm like, excuse me, I work really hard, thank you very much. But I will show that through actions rather than words. But no, so basically I started my company in 2018. I was working as a personal trainer on the side, which is actually how my partner and I met, but that's a story for another day. It was in 2020 with COVID when I was, furloughed. They furloughed as staff. Yeah. So I was like, perfect excuse to, you know, go full time with my company. Yeah. And that was really where it's like, right, I need to think about the finances a little bit more. So I run the events, which I've already mentioned. They are usually monthly, but I, you know, I try and run two or three a month if I can. And there's a bit of a gap in the summer if I'm not here. Then YouTube does pay. What I will say is I don't think anyone's making millions from YouTube, because they are not very generous. Just put it that way. So, you know, the numbers don't portray anything on my side. The numbers that I have on my platform, that is. So my primary income stream is actually my Patreon community. So if you're unfamiliar with Patreons or any of the listeners, Patreon is a platform that's designed entirely for creators, for us to create a membership based space where people pay monthly a designated amount. So I've got £3 up to £45, and every month they get something from me. I have been running that for a few years now and absolutely love it. It's a really sacred, safe space. It's completely international. People are sharing their journeys. It's so supportive. Last year, I did a massive reshuffle of my tiers. And so what that means is I can actually put more time into it. So I send postcards. I do audio diaries every day on the trail. So it's a bit more sort of inside on my journeys, what's going on in my mind. We do lots of live sessions. There's all sorts of things there. And then the final part, two parts, is I have my store for my merchandise, which is all sort of locally done and environmentally sensitive. The goal is that when we go, the products can go with us. Mm-hmm. And then, yeah, corporate stuff. So as I said, sort of talks and that sort of thing, where I go in and share my journey on a little bit more of an intimate level. Yeah. To really connect with people person to person.
Do you keep motivated? How do you keep, you know, because as you say, it's easy to get carried away with the actual the doing part, the exploring and touring and things like that. Mm. But how do you then keep motivated to do all the rest of it, the Patreon work, YouTube work and things like that?
So I think that's a really, really good question, because, you know, I'm a big believer that motivation comes with momentum. Yeah. And so, you know, when I go away, I don't tend to upload videos, because I found it's just impossible to be away and schedule all this content, not be able to promote it. So this year was the first year I sort of disappeared, quote unquote, offline. What that means is that my finances drop, my subscribers drop, like everything just disappears. And so you really have to separate yourself out from the numbers. So, you know, I might go, say I was putting in a pitch to you,
notice your subscribers, what if your YouTube are dropping because you've took a break for a week or two to make content?
Yeah. So again, I don't mind sharing. So my usual subscriber rate when I'm in full flow is about 2,000 subscribers coming in each month. Right now, I've mentioned I'm a month back, so I've had a month and a half off from uploading. Yeah. We're at about 100 in a month. So it's a significant drop. So you have to completely let all of that go, you know, be independent. Like, numbers do not equal success. And so where I'm really going with this is you have to be completely dialed in to your why. And that mission statement, that why, personal and professional, like mm-hmm. has to be at the forefront when you wake up. Like, why are you doing this? I've worked with business coaches, and I have a like life coach at the moment just to help me stay on track. And, you know, everybody's like, geez, you're juggling like five full-time jobs here. And I do keep hitting burnout. And one of the reasons why I went to the Arctic Circle was that so none of this could follow me and I could get back to who I am and not what I want to do with my life, but who I want to be with my life. Because, you know, from a very young age, so I've been making films since I was 13 years old. So that's literally like half my lifetime. I've had a camera in my hand. Like, I've had a fire in my like core and like a passion to use my voice as a means of creating a positive ripple effect of change. And, you know, you do burn out no matter how much you care and you want to try and help the world. And you do have to go away and recharge and reshuffle. And I think just because one system works on one day doesn't mean it works on another, because you have life around all of this as well. And so I think, to be honest, my main motivation is my little motto, like, is adapt and overcome. Because there's no 2 days that are the same. And I've mentioned I struggle with my mental health. I struggle with chronic pain. They impact me on a daily basis. So today I was supposed to put in 5 hours of editing and I had a migraine attack because of my injury. So I was in bed. And so, you know, if you let that bring you down, and then it's like, well, yeah, you're failing. But if you just use it as a, okay, this is an enforced rest. I'm going to give my body what it needs. I'm going to not mentally beat myself up for this, but take this as a recharge. Take this as a, I've had too much screen time in the last few days. Learn from it and then evolve as time moves on. So it's just a constant supporting yourself through the journey. And that's how you stay motivated. And, you know, if you're hitting your head against the wall, expecting results by doing the same thing, you know, it's not going to happen. You have to change in order to get different results.
Yeah. You have to take the blinkers off, because if you're that focused, then what are you not, you're not seeing anything around you.
Yeah.
And you'll become too focused on the numbers rather than what you actually are meant to be doing.
Yeah. But, you know, it's I think it's also just funny, because there's a lot of different types of people and a lot of different characters of people. And, you know, some people struggle to get themselves up and motivated to move. Like, I am not one of those people. You know, it is not a hard chore.
I think that's pretty clear, you're not.
Yeah. Like, oh, I have a 3-hour ride today. It's like, cool, that's exciting. You know, even if it's pouring down, in fact, the worse the weather is, the more exciting, because, you know, I've almost trained myself. And I think this is the thing, like, when you come up against adversity, if you actually approach that with an open heart and mind to learn from it, to see nothing as failure, but everything as an opportunity to learn and grow, then you're always moving forwards. So like, almost the harder the things get over time, the more you're like, well, go on then, game on. You know, what is that saying? Like, I've survived 100% of my worst moments so far. And it's like, yeah. And you know what? If you keep going, like, you're going to keep going. It's when you stop that there's a problem. It's when you give up that there's a problem. It's when you let somebody else take the wheel that there's a problem. And whereas if you like just accept all these different parts of yourself and you go, well, then I just need to figure out my way of doing this, then that's how you keep motivated. You know, it's with my pain, it's like, I would rather be in pain doing something than nothing. Like, my pain could stop me from diving. Like, it hurts. You know, my pain could stop me from hiking. It hurts, but it doesn't, because if I can channel that pain into something else, or just know that it's going to be there whether I'm doing something or nothing, it's like, well, let's just crack on with life and do something.
Yeah.
So,
Because otherwise you could be just sitting on the sofa and being governed by the pain that you've got and, you know, moving on, not moving on. And I think that's a really good point that you've made.
And you must see so many different people in your experiences with, you know, corporate, private people, and hopefully see them change, or give them medium to change anyway.
That's it. And it, you know, it's, I think that's the other thing is, you know, I'm really pulling on a lot of my values here and my business values, because they are what I live by and what I strive to communicate. But One of the other things I communicate through my films is that adventure is an attitude. Okay, cool. I've talked about hiking Mont Blanc and in the Arctic Circle, but for flip's sake, sometimes it's really hard to just get myself out to walk the mile and a half loop around my house. Like, it's not every day I'm being, you know, heroic and doing this crazy gnarly stuff. Like sometimes that's the push. And I think, again, it's just being graceful enough with yourself to accept that, like, if you apply that adventure attitude, you know, learning a new instrument, reading a new book that's got big words in, like, learning a new skill, signing up for a course. Like, I struggle with, like, public events, funnily enough, like, because I'm a very introverted person. But it's like, if you apply that adventure attitude that, like, you can have fun, you can learn from this, be yourself, all of those things, then it makes life a lot more interesting. So yeah, you don't have to do something crazy and gnarly to have an adventure. Like, there's adventure on our doorstep. And for me, again, that's what diving, to sort of bring it full circle, really illuminates very, very powerfully, is that you don't have to go to the furthest corners of the earth and see the biggest animals, which is very exciting, and I would love to do that. But, you know, go to your nearest coastline, and there's an adventure waiting to happen.
Yeah, so, and I think not take everything so seriously, or, you know, embrace the fun, and the, you know, that's just, it keeps everything alive, doesn't it?
Yeah.
So what's been one of the biggest things that surprised you about yourself that you've learned from all this?
It doesn't take me very long to get really stinky. Yeah, that's too surprising. Well, you know, you guys
are something more deep and meaningful.
Yeah, you only get the 2D experience through these films. You're being spared. No, honestly, what surprises me is when I'm on the trail, I do experience my pain, but I generally feel a lot better than I do when I'm at home. And that's really difficult, because it means you start to dread coming back. And what I've learned about myself is intentionality is a massive part of how I get through each day. So, you know, I draw a lot of strength from the past experiences that I've gone through, particularly, you know, those difficult times, but also the amazing times. And for example, this Arctic Circle trip, I went there to think about some pretty tough stuff, and I really did, actually, amazingly, I didn't know it was possible, but let some stuff go. And now I'm back, and I'm sort of back into my cycle of being in pain. You know, screens are not great for me and all that, but they're part of my job. And I've almost sort of distanced myself from that trip. I'm like, did that really happen? Like, am I, you know, there's part of my mental health stuff is that, you know, I very severely question things that have happened in my life. So it's no joke when I'm saying, like, did that really happen? When I was in Stockholm, I actually got a tattoo on my rib cage. It's on my Instagram platform at the moment, of some reindeer, because there's lots of reindeer in the Arctic Circle. And if I didn't have that tattoo, I would probably feel really lost right now, but that's grounding me. But what it's representing is the journeys that are within us. And, you know, I tend to say, when you go on the trail, like, you start as one puzzle shape and you finish as another. Like, you always change on these trails because of what you go through. And I think, you know, when I come back home, I find myself trying to force myself to be the shape that I was when I left, but it doesn't work. Like, I have to live out the person that I am now, having grown and evolved in a very compact, short space of time. And I think where I'm really going with this is I've learned that there's so much resilience in me to keep going. And endurance is just kind of my thing. And I think if I didn't have that desire to endure, like, it would have all been over a long time ago. But, you know, what is powerful about this is that we all have this within us, this ability to endure, and that our greatest enemy, I think, is, you know, it's probably a very cliche thing to say, but it's not those outside of us, it's entirely within us. Like, we are our greatest enemy, and I see that within myself. You know, I come home and I do fall into the pits of self-pity, of like, crap, you know, I'm back into these migraines, this pain, like, it hurts, like, I'm not feeling motivated, don't want to do the screen time, whatever. But if you can learn to hold a mirror up to those comments that you say in your head, if you can learn to say them out loud so they sound rubbish and you realize what's going on, that's when you have the power to flip them and go, okay, this is a reality I'm creating for myself. Like, I can create an entirely different reality if I choose to do so. And I think, you know, on the trail that I just did in the Arctic Circle, that's where I really felt the revelation of that more than anywhere else, because I had to push through so many obstacles to get there. And I was entirely by myself. So the only way I could complete that trip was by myself. And it's just that complete, obvious, undeniable truth that we are entirely reliant on ourselves and nobody else.
Yeah.
And that just how much of everything around us is in our head. And so coming back, that's what I'm really trying to put into practice and to play around with. It's just that power of being who we really are inside. And, you know, when you're alone in these places, you have to face the nasty sides as well. You know, those vulnerable sides, those sides where you know, that kid inside of you is like, I don't like this, I'm going to have a tantrum or whatever it looks like. And, you know, you get familiar with those versions of yourself and you come back, and it's just that understanding that you're all these different facets and there's nothing right and there's nothing wrong. Like, we just are, and that's totally okay. And I really hope that this film, you know, brings some of these things across. Like, as you can probably hear, there's so much to all of this, and on the surface it looks like I'm just going for a hike, but these are very deep spiritual experiences, and they're available to everybody, you know, whether it's through scuba diving or hiking or another activity that people enjoy. It's with that intentionality that you can learn so much about yourself.
And getting outside of four walls especially, that gives you the space to, you know, even if you are alone, you've got that space to
but diving is good for that as well, because diving is a good time when you can just hear
it's silent underwater, isn't it?
Hear the sound of the water, and you know, you are alert. Apart from if you've got a full face mask, you hear beep. You all right? Yeah.
beep.
Anyway, but you can, you know, generally you are alone with your thoughts, you know, and it is a good time to you know, go through that, and it does get your time away from mobile phones and all this other stuff of the daily grind, you know. And I think it's really good for people's mental health. You know, don't matter what caliber and how good a diver you are, if you're getting underwater, you know, it's just that you're feeling that connection with the water. And if you are underwater, you're getting that peace, you know. And I think we all need a bit of that, really, in our daily grinds.
We've spoken to so many people that as soon as they're underwater, their whole being kind of changes, doesn't it? Or they've kind of, then that's changed their path in life a little bit. It's just because of that change in environment.
Yeah, that's it. I have to say, you know, I'm a very shallow breather, which doesn't work wonders for anxiety. And I try and focus on my breath on the land, and it's a bit pathetic, quite frankly. But then underwater, I'm like, oh, I didn't know I had this depth to my lungs. It's like just breathing really calmly. And it's like, I wish I could do this on the land. But like, you're right. It just, whilst it's, you know, such an foreign place for us to be as human beings, like in some ways, when you trust your kit and you trust yourself and you trust the people around you, like, it is so relaxing.
It is.
Just like, this is amazing.
To get that feeling where you're just like floating. Those times are just, you think, wow.
Yeah, it's really, really great experience. Yeah.
Yeah. No, really interesting. Amazing. So we'll ask you some questions then.
Game on.
So what takes you out of your comfort zone?
Well, I've alluded to a couple, you know. First of all, obviously going in the water is one of those big ones that probably should be on this pod. But I'm very anxious around people, which, you know, doesn't tend to come across on the surface, but it's a massive deal for me. And, you know, for example, if I'm driving to an event that I'm hosting, you know, I'll use the last 20 minutes to be like, right, what's my intentionality? What do I hope to give? Who do I want to be on this? And how do I hope to be perceived? But, you know, just a couple of days ago, we were up in London. And so my friends are like, you're in London? Like, the Abbie Barnes is in London. Did you lose your map or something? I was like, but I had this gig thing that we had to go and do for the business. But anyway, you know, that is intimidating for me. Yeah. Like urban environments, I find very hard, because I feel very out of my depth and like I don't really belong. But again, it's just like, we'll apply all the usual stuff. But like, that is my out of my comfort zone is urban areas and sort of quite formal gatherings where I probably shouldn't wear my hat, and I rebel and do so anyway. Yeah. So well, that's probably not a great answer, but that's the jam. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, be yourself. That's the main thing, isn't it? Yeah.
If I can't be myself, I don't want to be there.
No.
No, I don't blame you either.
Yeah.
So can you give us three people that you would take diving?
Can I just say, this question was so hard. Like, when I saw this on the brief, this is why, like, right, I can't listen to any episodes because I need to think and use my own brain for this.
Tell me someone from history, you know?
Well, no, I have answers now, but like, I had to really go into the places and get the cogs working, you know? So thank you for the brain exercise. But no, I came up with like an icon. So I thought somebody that people will probably know. So that's Steve Backshall, who's a wildlife presenter, because yeah. I find his energetic, surprisingly, but just really, really enthusiastic, super knowledgeable. And he's somebody who inspired me a lot as a young person. Yeah. So the second person in thanks, I would like to bring one of my dive instructors. So either Midge or Vic, so they can do rock, paper, scissors and decide, because I think it's nice to give back. And the third person, I can't even count to three, is somebody who has never dived before and would like to give it a go, because what a great opportunity to get someone new in the water. So come along, brilliant. Folks, let's go.
That's a good choice.
Yeah. And I think they're probably different ones to what we've had.
Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah. So that's really good. Yeah.
Great. So I can listen to all your episodes now.
You can now.
Yeah. Cool. I don't think anyone's said Steve Backshall.
No. Okay. That's first.
Or any non-diver. So no.
Cool. Well, you know, I like to be different.
Yeah, very good.
Cool. And then our final question is, if you could have a billboard that the whole world would see, so it doesn't have, it could be a video, a statement, a picture, what would you put on your billboard and why?
This is also a very cruel but amazing question. I've spent a lot of cycles thinking about this, but this is what I've come up with, and I'm going to read it because I wrote it down, so I say it verbatim. So it's an African proverb, and it's something that I've been thinking on a lot this year. And it's, if you think you're too small to make a difference, try sleeping with a mosquito. And for me, I was like, oh man, that hits the point. Just because, you know, like so many people are like, oh, that's one small thing. That doesn't matter. I can, you know, buy those grapes in plastic or drive to the school for the pickup. And, it, you know, that's not going to make a difference. And it's like, but it does, people. Like every small action adds up. You know, when I was 15, I made this film called Save Our Oceans, talking about plastic waste. And I was talking about every little thing, every little choice we make not only influences life now, but life in the future. And we can empower ourselves to make a difference and change this world. And if we start putting excuses in the way, like saying, oh, it doesn't matter, then it's like we're never gonna change. And you know, that's not just for climate change and conservation, that's also for ourselves. Like if you're gonna skip that run or skip that walk or eat something that you don't want to eat, like that is gonna make a difference in one way or another. And you owe it to yourself to live the best life possible and honor who you want to be. And, you know, so often those excuses and obstacles come in the way and they stop us living our best life. And I'm not going to lie, living your best life is flipping hard. You have to be disciplined. You have to be intentional. But that's almost what makes it so much more rewarding.
Yeah.
As you can see, I'm rather passionate about this. So small things do add up in every sense of the word. And so if you set yourself goals and intentions on any given day or in any given week, like honor them, stick to them. And if you can't stick to something because of things that happen, just adapt, overcome. You know, if you really are feeling too tired to go for that run or go to that meeting, then cut it down, make it smaller, take those small steps because they still count in the bigger picture.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's brilliant.
Really, really,
really
good.
We, about a year ago, we had a guest on called Dave Kennett. Okay. And one of the things he's got a following on the West Coast called
Neptune Army of Rubbish Cleaners.
Yes.
Ooh, okay. And nice.
One of the things, on a very similar note that you've said, one of the things he talks about is looking after your own back garden.
Mm-hmm.
And if everyone did that, what a difference that all made, you know, because we can't all be explorers. We can't all go out and do stuff, and then that's fine, you know. Yeah. But when you look around and you see all the litter and stuff and, you know, whatever, but if everyone looked after their own backyard, whether it's on the coast, whether it's inland, what a difference that would make. And when you get a lot of people doing good stuff.
Yeah, no matter how small it is.
Yeah.
Which comes around to what you've said, Abby. You know, it's all the small things that make the bigger difference. Yeah.
2 minute beach clean, another one.
Yeah.
Exactly. Or just, you know, you're walking somewhere, you see some litter, pick it up. Like, there's one less thing that's going to make it into our waterways. And that's amazing. And you know what? It is really scary to look at the amount of rubbish in the world. But like, don't look at the bigger picture. Look at every single step that you take. You know, I just hiked for 21 days. I couldn't look at the end of that trail. There was no guarantee I was going to make that. It's just one step at a time, one day at a time. Mm-hmm. And you know, we all hit dark patches in our life. And sometimes all we can do is clean our teeth and water the houseplants. But do you know what? That's cool, because every little step adds up. And it's just translatable in every possible sense. So that's why I love that quote, because A, I suffer very badly from mosquito bites. But it really goes to show that, you know, small things can make a difference.
And there's nothing worse being either in your bed or in a tent.
Yeah.
And you hear that.
Yeah.
And you're like, where is it?
Yeah. My partner is amazing. If she hears one and it's dark, like, she'll just jump up, find the nearest like paper thing, and just be in like full karate mode. And I'm just there like, okay, here we go.
It's like war.
Yeah, it literally is. I'm like, there is going to be bloodshed tonight.
Yeah. Well, it's been brilliant chatting to you, Abby. It's just like amazing. Yeah. And everything. You know, I know, you know, we talk to scuba divers, but everything that you said just applies to everything.
Everybody.
I think that, you know, that is the goal. It's all embracing nature and knowing that everything we can learn from natural experiences, whether in the water or on the land, are completely translatable. So it's you know, it's owning your journey, it's trusting the process and just enjoying every step of it.
Yeah, and having fun and being kind to yourself as well at the end of the day as well. I think that's probably another part of it. Yeah.
Exactly, spot on.
So for the listeners out there who not heard of you, and this they're listening to you for the first time, where do they need to go to follow you and keep up with your adventures?
Well, first of all, thank you for being interested enough to follow along. So I'm best well known for my YouTube channel, which if you put in Abbie Barnes, which you can probably see in the title of this podcast spelling wise, because Abbie is spelt in a myriad of ways, then you'll find me. So dive into over 400 videos on there.
Wow.
See you in a few months. But then otherwise, you know, my main social platform is Instagram, just because you can do the reels. But then I'm also on Facebook. And if you're not on socials, good effort. You can subscribe to my newsletter on my website, which is spendmoretimeinthewild.co.uk.
Excellent. Yeah. Well, I'm sure. Yeah. We'll put all the links in the show notes so people can click there and find you easily as well.
That's fab.
Yeah.
Fantastic.
Really great to finally catch up with you. And we look forward to watching your adventures going forward and hopefully some under the water as well.
Yeah. Thank you very much for coming on. It's been absolutely brilliant. Yeah.
Thank you so much, folks. It's been really good fun. And thank you for what you do, sharing these stories and these episodes as well. And hopefully dive with you in the future at some point.
That'd be cool.
Good. Yeah, we'll go hiking somewhere as well.
That's it. We can trade skills. Love it. You take care.
Yeah, lovely to see you. Have a good evening, Abby.
Bye.
Cheers. Bye. Well, that was really good, wasn't it? Did you like that?
Yeah, really. Well, it's very inspiring and quite deep in places, but it's on a level that everybody can reflect on, I think, and apply to themselves.
Yeah, I agree. And love the hat, and really good to see the brand. And you can see the motivation and the positivity about her coming through when we talked to her. And so definitely, you know, we'll say thanks for Abby to coming on and spending that time with us. So
yes, and it's it's great that we've, you know, we don't just, we're not just about diving. We talk to people that have all these different elements within their world. And, you know, diving is part of her world, but she's brought, you know, something that everybody else can apply, I think.
Oh, definitely. You know, the thing about the diving is that, you know, for a lot of people, that's only one part of the life, you know, just off the top of my head, someone like, you know, one of the big divers that we all know is Andy Torbert. Look at the other things that he does, you know, exactly. jumping out of planes, walking on hot air balloons, and, you know, all the other mad things that he does. And
they're all facing things of adventure, whether they're, you know, they're within their comfort zone or out of their comfort zone. You know, it's just really, really good to see that perspective.
Yes, and I think with us, you know, as a podcast, if you listen to us, and, you know, we do try and find the other side of diving where people are. You know, yes, you know, people do come on and talk to us about just diving, and people come on to us and talk about diving and other parts and other sort of things and other skills. And, you know, I think of someone else like Dave Conlon, who came on and talked to us about how they preserve the USS Arizona and things like that. You know, and diving was one part of it. And so, yeah, it's good to bring someone on like Abbie and find out about how those skills bridge across going up somewhere like where she's just been.
Well, it's almost like life skills and, you know, reflecting on how you proceed in life.
Doesn't it show you how difficult diving is?
Yeah.
You know, when you think of the, you know, the safety elements and the skill to get down to, let's say, 100 meters or go past 40 meters, you know, 40 meters, 41 meters up a hill. You know, that's a big hill.
Yeah. But,
you know, most people can do that. Most people can go up Snowdon.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. And that's, you know, what, over 1,000 meters. Yeah.
But only very few people can dive down below 40 odd meters, 40 meters.
Well, any recreational diver, they have got a limit to where they should go.
Well, 40 meters, but, yeah. You know, do you see my point? You know, that is how hard diving is. And that's why I think, you know, being a bit scared is not necessarily a bad thing when you're diving. Me and how to manage that and say, yeah, you know, I should be concerned, but it's okay. That's when you rely on your training. And everything else, you know, that you do, you experience, and the people you dive with, to then feel and say, right, I'm gonna park that and enjoy the dive.
Never
take things for granted.
No, and I think, yeah, Abbie's been through some ups and downs through her journey, and, you know, she's using those times to in life, and, you know, hopefully share those experiences to make other people look at themselves and make themselves better people as well, or able to cope with harder things.
It was interesting what Abbie said as well about managing the production of social media as well, because it's very, you know, we find that, don't we, about, you know, keeping up with social media, you know, posting stories and all that.
It's not a numbers game.
And all that. And diving, especially with diving, probably more than walking, really, diving is a lot more of a niche sport. We love the sport, but in reality, you know, a lot fewer people dive than they do walking and hill walking and what have you, you know. And that's just the fact of it, you know, is a lot more of a niche sport.
But again, with her, the way she spoke about that with social media and YouTube channels, it's not all about generating these numbers.
You can't, I don't think you can, because you lose sense, you lose touch of
what are you doing this for
in the first place. Are you just doing it for numbers, and then I think you would lose numbers because your content would go down.
Yeah. And, you know, from our point of view, it's more about the guest and what they can bring to our listeners is the thing that spurs.
Yeah, it was really good. And That's really nice of Abbie to come on and share that with us, really.
Yeah, really good. And obviously take a look at her YouTube channels and watch her on Instagram as well.
Yeah, sure, definitely.
It'd be interesting. Yeah, and her answers were brilliant.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, you know, and that's good. I thought Steve Baxwell, brilliant. Her dive instructors, you know, chose a good relationship with your instructor, with her instructors, and also asked them, you know, to take someone down who's any non-diver to show them why to start diving is, you know, is a good choice.
So that was our guest today. So
we've got
plenty more planned for the coming months, haven't
we've
we?
Got a busy winter
we have we? Yeah,
interviews, or and I can still think of some other people actually we've got to speak to.
The summer's been great because we've been diving, we've been out and about, we've had work, family time, so now's the time. Yeah, we're gonna get back into recording and talk to these
kids
amazing
are back
guests
at school.
I was half term seeing this. But we've got some exciting guests coming up. So we're recording again Wednesday and Friday. So it'd be all good stuff.
it is. Yeah.
Yeah. So don't forget, we have got a whole 160 episodes.
Already recorded and in the can.
So if you fancy a little listen.
And I thought we're only being around 5 minutes. We've been doing this nearly 4 years.
I know. if you're new to the podcast,
some people thought we'd disappear into the.
I know they did, didn't they? But we're not going anywhere.
And still here, still here, annoying them. You know who you are.
All right, less of that. Yes, so 160 episodes. Yes, have a dial back. All the names, the guests, and some short descriptions are on each episode, so you'll be able to, if you want to pick and choose, or just put them on play and listen to us on your commute or while you're chilling or running or doing whatever you do to relax and listen to a podcast.
Absolutely. Well, say thank you very much for downloading this episode. Thanks for listening. If you've got any guests, by all means, you know, put them forward to us, send us an email. It's always good to hear from our listener. Don't forget to leave us a 5-star review on iTunes because it helps your dive buddy find us. By all means, look out for us with our flag and signs when we're diving. We always hoist up the flag for people to see.
It's a big sale, yes.
We are. Come and find us because we're always giving our lovely friends who sponsor us, Narked at 90, they've got some of these lovely slap straps, aren't they?
Yes, that you put on the back of your mask. Yeah.
So, you know, always come up to us and, we'll give you a shout out. We should also shout out this weekend is the 70th anniversary of BZAC.
Yes, so amazing, isn't it?
Yeah, 70 years. So that's pretty cool.
Yeah, and just going back to Narked at 90, we've got a discount code that you might be interested in if you're going to put an order in with Narked at 90. So drop us a message and then we can give you some more details. Just need you to...
Saving people money?
Yes. Yeah. So
of course
that. Just need you to follow Narked at 90 on their Facebook page and then we can pop the code across to you. So it's coming up to Christmas. So there's awesome
good... They do some really cool shearwater... protection sleeves as well.
Your dive computer, yes, yeah.
So and great lamps, canister. Yeah.
Yes, yeah. So there's hoses. There's all sorts of like little gift ideas that might be useful for the diver in your life.
So that's really cool.
So take a look at their website. Yeah, it's www.narked90.com.
Yeah, and if there's something that you see, message us, and we'll give you that money off code.
So I think that's about it, isn't it?
I think so. I think that's it. As just, you know, if you've got a guest idea or if you've got a story that you want to talk to us about and you think it'd be really cool to share with our listeners, your fellow listeners, then drop us a message, drop us an email, whether it's on Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn, what else do we do? Threads.
Yes, or you can email us. That's
or email us.
Yes. The good old fashioned way. So but yeah, if you've got any comments, we always love hearing from you. So please do communicate.
You could even try sending a pigeon, do pigeon pose.
Yeah, or just wave at us when we're at a dive centre somewhere or a dive site. So we had people waving us while we were underwater at Stony Cove, didn't we?
Oh yeah, we did.
Somebody knew my name who I didn't know. That's very bizarre. But yeah, so yeah, I'm sure we'll be at Stony Cove sometime in the near future, won't we?
I'm on DM duty in October, I think latter part of October.
Yes.
And in November.
Yeah.
We're talking about nearly the winter already.
I know, it's the 2nd of October already. But yeah, keep dialed into our social media posts and we'll announce where we are and what we're doing on there.
Yeah. So there we go. So look at Abbie Barnes, look her up. And look up narked@90.com. Look at our website, thebigscuba.com. You've got three things there to look up. And I think that's kind of it. The storm managed to disappear, so that's gone. And we managed to get this recording all finished.
Yes.
And job done. So hope you enjoyed this one. But for right now, that was
The Big Scuba Podcast.
See you soon.
Today's episode is sponsored by Narked at 90, so let's find out a bit more about them. Narked at 90, their tagline has been beyond technical, which describes them pretty well. John Routley and Brent Hudson launched the company over 20 years ago. They are both technical divers who have logged thousands of mixed gas dives between them over a 30-year period. Using their engineering know-how and diving expertise, have developed bespoke, personal, commercial and military diving equipment and products of a universally recognised, unparalleled calibre.
Their ability to be adaptive and versatile with their developments led them to support the NHS during COVID. Using their superior knowledge of breathing and oxygen monitoring systems to help develop emergency ventilators, they also design and supply the sneaky stuff used by defence-based development groups throughout the Western world, although they can't tell us much about that. If you're thinking of moving across to tech diving or completely new to diving, Narked at 90 can advise and guide on the best equipment and setup for your personal or commercial requirements. Narked at 90 have unparalleled experience of shearwater dive computers and are the longest serving and sole and UK European service centre for those. They are happy to offer technical support, servicing, repairs and upgrades to all shearwater computers, past and present. Narked at 90 stock shearwater computers, but are also stockers and technical support centre for many other manufacturers, including Divesoft, JJCCR, Hollis, Revo and Kiss Rebreathers.
Based centrally in the UK, Narked at 90 also offer full rebreather head servicing for selected manufacturers.
Bespoke cable assemblies.
Advice on specific fitting requirements.
Suggestions and guidance for home builds.
Computer laser cutting and engraving.
Pressure testing to simulate 400 metre dives.
So, Narked at 90, a reputation built on supporting both manufacturers and divers worldwide.
Go to narked90.com and make sure you are following their social media to keep up to date with their latest news and offers.
Narked at 90, large enough to cope, small enough to care.
Now that does wrap up today's episode of the Big Scuba Podcast. But if you want to hear more from the podcast, make sure you hit that subscribe or follow button depending on what platform you are listening on. That way, you will never miss an episode from us. But if you are listening on Apple Podcasts and did enjoy what you heard today, we would really appreciate it if you head to the show page to leave a 5-star rating and review. It really does help us. If you do, please take a screenshot of that review and send it to us on Instagram and we'll give you a shout out to say a big thank you. If you have any questions for us or anything that has been mentioned in today's episode, be sure to reach out to us on any of our social media platforms or send us an email. The links are in the show notes. We will get back to you no matter what. If you have made it to this point in the episode, we both want to say a big, big thank you for tuning in, and we'll see you on the next episode.